Welcome to our Saturday night session here. Let me tell you a little bit about what the program is. It's going to be pretty simple. Our speaker is going to introduce himself tonight. So I'm not going to introduce him. He's going to tell a little bit about himself and his background and give his history. And then it's going to be open for Q&A. So if you've got questions, start thinking about them now. And before I ask Arnold to come up, I'm going to just start this out with a request to the Lord for his blessing on tonight. So shall we pray? Our great and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for this gathering together tonight, and we ask that you open all of our hearts to receive your word as it's proclaimed tonight. We ask you to be with our speaker. We ask you to give him his insights, and we thank you for his life and his testimony and what he's meant to the Christian faith. We ask all of these things in the name of your Son who died on the cross, that we might spend eternity with you. Amen. Arnold.
Okay, are we on? Okay. I was asked to share my testimony for this session tonight. Let's begin my testimony from two passages of scripture. If you have your Bibles with you, you can turn to Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19. Because anybody who has a Jewish testimony, this is really where this testimony would begin. Luke 19 and verse 41. Luke 19, verse 41. When he drew nigh, he saw the city and wept over it, saying, "If you had known in this day, even you, the things which belong unto peace, but now they are hid from your eyes. For the day shall come upon you when your enemy shall cast up a bank about you and compass you round and keep you in every side, and shall dash you to the ground and your children within you. And they will not leave in you one stone on top of another, because you did not know the time of your visitation." Let's skip over to chapter 21 and verse 24. 21 and verse 24. "And they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled." Now 40 years after the Messiah said these words, the legions of Rome invaded the land. After a four-year war and a two-year siege, the city and the temple were destroyed, and the Jewish people were dispersed throughout the world. And Jewish history now goes to a period we simply call the Diaspora, the worldwide dispersion of the Jewish people, and they're literally scattered throughout the world. In many prophecy conferences in the early segments of the 20th century, there was many prophecy conferences, and one common statement was often made: in fulfillment of Bible prophecy, you'll find the Jews in all seven continents, except for the continent of the Antarctica. Now, I know a Jewish believer is not with the Lord, but he was involved in those conferences, and he heard that term, that statement made one more time, and he sort of got an idea in his head and smirked and told the person sitting next to him, "What that man just said is not true. It's not true you'll find the Jews in all seven continents except for the Antarctica. You'll find the Jewish people even in the Antarctica, because everyone has heard about the icebergs." Now, if you know something about Jewish names, you'll get the pun. But that pictures that worldwide dispersion. But sadly, in the dispersion, the Jews became a persecuted people. And more sadly, is in the 4th century, 95% of all persecutions against the Jews were committed in the name of the three C's: the Church, the Cross, and Christ. No sooner did the Jewish community find itself settled in some segment of Europe, eventually an anti-Semite will get control of that section, either drive the Jews out or to kill them and things of that nature. Now, in the 1600s, Poland was opened up for Jewish immigration, and Jews fleeing persecution elsewhere would move into Poland. In the course of time, the Polish Jewish community was the largest Jewish community in the world, having the similar influence that the American Jewish community would have today. It was among the Polish Jews a new sect began to develop that called themselves the Hasidim, a word that means the pious ones, but refers to the ultra-Orthodox Jewish people. who were very strong on committed to the Mosaic law, both Soteriological traditions and commentaries that were passed down by the rabbis from ancient times. And when the founder of the movement passed away, the movement split up into divisions, not based upon theology, but based upon geography. And in this section of Poland called Poltowska, about 50 miles north of Warsaw, there was a Hasidic community, and leadership fell in the authority of the Fruchtenbaum family. And so my grandfather's father before him, his father before him, were leaders of this ultra-Orthodox group. And you being the decision-making process when new issues began to arise in the Jewish community. So for example, tomatoes came on the Polish market for the first time. And among the Jewish people, this big debate broke out about the tomato. Were tomatoes kosher or non-kosher? And Moses forgot to tell us whether it was kosher or not kosher. And so you had the pro-tomato party on this end, the anti-tomato party on the other hand. Maybe they threw some at each other, I don't know. But then they formed a delegation to see my grandfather about it, and he heard their arguments, told them to come back several days later. He bought some tomatoes and cut them up into various sizes. He studied the skin, the seeds, the content. He pulled out all of the Jewish law books concerning what was permissible to eat in the vegetarian state. And when they came back after a few days, he told them that tomatoes were kosher, at least for that community, they're allowed to eat tomatoes. He passed away because of an appendicitis attack, and then my father was next in line. But the whole process was interrupted on September 1st, 1941, with the German invasion of Poland. And this was actually 1939 with the Polish invasion of the Germans on Poland. And Nazism came in. My father was able to escape into Russia. He was arrested by the Russian authorities, and although they knew he was a Jew, they accused him of being a Nazi spy and shipped him out to a concentration camp into Siberia, where he languished for 2 years until 1941. In that year, Hitler broke his treaty with Stalin and invaded the then Soviet Union. And the Russian government was now in need of the Polish government, now exiled in England. They requested that support, and the Polish government agreed, but they laid down certain preconditions, one of which was the release of all Polish citizens from Russian prisons. So for that reason, my father was released. For the same reason, a man named Menachem Begin was released. Now, Menachem Begin went on to become the Prime Minister of Israel. My father went on to become a professional photographer in California, but that's another story. Because the Germans were occupying much of the western part of Russia, my father chose to wait the war out in Siberia, and he managed to the profession of photography. My mother was shipped to Siberia from another part of Russia. She had just became legally an adult and had to get some identification papers and needed some passport-type pictures. And she heard about my father's photography, so she went to him to get a picture taken. Her picture got taken, and I developed. So I was born in Russia in 1943, and that will help to explain just one segment of the accent you're listening to. When the war ended, those who were Polish citizens could return to Poland, that now had become a communist country. And so he moved back to Poland, set in a small Jewish community in this city, stayed there for about a year, and that will help to explain the second segment of the accent you're listening to. But towards the end of a year in Poland, the Jewish Passover arrived, and about that time, when the Jewish mothers were baking the special matzot, the special unleavened bread for the Passover, a small three-year-old Roman Catholic boy disappeared. And the church leaders began spreading a rumor that often had spread before. In order for the Jews to make unleavened bread for Passover, we have to use the blood of a Christian. So accused of kidnapping the small boy, using him and killing him in a form of ritual murder, and then using his blood to make unleavened bread. And rumor got spread throughout the country. And so on the first night of the Passover, outside our ghetto and other Jewish ghettos around the country, Polish mobs were formed with the help of the Polish police and led out by the priesthood in their black robes carrying crosses. They began to raid the Jewish sectors and kept crying the same line, "You kill Christ and so we'll kill you." And that's the first context I heard about this person called Christ. When I first was introduced to him, it was not as my Messiah, not someone who came to die for my sins, or was someone we have to be dying for. The one good thing that came out of the Polish riot was the work of the Israeli underground. It was then called the Palestinian underground, but was at that point the term that applied to the Jews of the land of Israel. And they began to work with the Polish border guards and bribe them. And for a set period of time, they allowed any Jewish person to cross the border from Poland into what was then Czechoslovakia. And we were rich to the underground that we had those 30 days. So my parents decided to make the break. We joined with other Jews that made the same decision. We could not use public transportation because it might attract unnecessary attention. We could only walk the many, many miles to the border. Upon arrival, we were stopped by the Polish border guards. We identified ourselves as Jews. At that point, the border guards took the rifles, put them behind their backs, raised the right skyward, and went like so. The point was they were looking at the birds flying in the sky and pretending they could not see us, and that's the way we got across the border. Later from the Israelis, we found out how much it took to bribe these border guards, and that was American cigarettes. American cigarettes were highly valued in East Europe after World War II and sold for a carton of Camels. You could purchase the freedom of a family of Jews, and that's how we got out. So while smoking may be bad for your health, it was good for mine. And that was the one day I really did walk a mile for a Camel. Now, for several hours we were in this no man's land area between Poland and Czechoslovakia, and the Israeli underground got us organized, and then we had to walk on foot to the Czechoslovak forest, heading for the Austrian border, where a similar arrangement had been made with the Czech border police as well. It took several weeks to walk the width of the country. But the day before we were to cross the border, the Czech government collapsed, the communists took over, all of the Czech border guards removed and replaced by Russian border police, with whom no arrangements had been made. And as a result, we weren't sure what was going to happen, but we were told to stay hidden in the forest. And the Israelis went down to the border area, the border town, to investigate the situation, and what they discovered was one key truth. The Polish border guards were given orders to allow no one across the border except for Greeks. Greeks recently released from certain camps heading back to their own homeland. When they found this out, they came back and were told to burn all our identification papers. So birth certificates, marriage licenses, other legal documents went up in smoke. The next morning, we're told to pose as Greeks. And pretending to be Greeks, we then approached the Russians at the Czecho-Austrian border. Now, not one of us was a Greek. Not one of us could speak a single word in Greek, but neither could the Russians. As a result, we got across safely into Czechoslovakia. Something went wrong at the last minute, and one of the Israelis was shot and killed, but that was the only casualty. So pretending to be Greeks, we made it into Austria. Then I found myself in the example of Romans 1:16, in that I was a Jew first, and for one day also a Greek. The American MPs took over from the Israelis and brought us into the American zone of West Germany. And for the next 5 years, we spent living in different camps known as displaced persons camps. These were camps of Jewish people that no longer had citizenship in any country, and had to be evaluated before they received immigration status to one of the Western countries. So 5 years in West Germany will explain a third segment of the accent you're listening to. What even happened in one of these camps, and the camp were there for about 3 years, that came only about 1 year, and they later forced me to face the issue of the Messiahship of the Yeshua, the Messiahship of Jesus. And there was a Lutheran representative who was a Lutheran pastor, a Bible-believing one, who was working on behalf of the Jewish ministry. His first responsibility was to hand out clothing for Jewish refugees, which we were, and that's how first contact was made. And during the year we lived in this one camp, he and his daughter made several visits to the camp. I was not involved in the conversations. I don't know what they talked about. What I do know is that when he learned we had applied for immigration status to the USA, he had a magazine called The Chosen People. That was published by a Messianic group in New York City. And the cover of the magazine had the headquarters address in New York. He did not give my mother the whole magazine, so she never knew exactly what the group was. He tore the cover off and told her, when we come to America, to look this group up and they'll be able to help us. All my mother understood was that this was a Jewish group in America that will help immigrant Jews, which is something they were doing, but there was more to it, and by the time my mother found that out, it was too late in my case. And so after 5 years living in Germany and having 3 years of that slip of paper in her purse, we finally got our immigration papers, and we left Germany, sailed to New York, settled in Brooklyn, New York, and Brooklyn explained the rest of the accent that you've been listening to. I learned English in Brooklyn, and nobody in Brooklyn had any difficulty understanding me. But when later we moved to Los Angeles and went to high school there, within a week they put me into a speech impediment class. So Brooklynese was quite distinctive, which I did not realize until I moved to California. While in Brooklyn, my mother went to visit that New York headquarters address of the ministry, and at that point she could not speak English. And at the day that she arrived, nobody there could speak Russian or Polish or Yiddish or German, all of which my mother spoke. So all that got done that day was the name and address was taken down on a 3x5 card, was conveyed to her. We'd be contacted sometime later. And sometime later turned out to be 6 years later. The follow-up program was a bit weak at this stage, and we had nothing for the next 6 years. But then they opened up a new branch in our section of Brooklyn, just about a mile from where we're living. So they pulled out these contact cards and gave it out to different workers, and a worker came by inviting us to attend what they then called a Jewish Christian meeting. When I first heard that term, this to me was a contradiction of terms, because I was raised to believe you're either a Jew or a Christian, but you cannot be both. But someone that called himself both a Jew and a Christian meant he was probably schizophrenic, two things in one. But my curiosity was aroused, so I went into this meeting hall. It was a very small meeting hall, only about, I'd say, quarter the size of this meeting hall. I sat in the back to listen to what they were saying. It did not bother me that much. They kept talking about this Yeshua, this Jesus. I was expecting that much from what I was told previously. What was disturbing me is they kept using the Hebrew Bible to do it with. Because I grew up believing we Jews have our Bible, the Hebrew Bible, called by Christians the Old Testament, and the Christians had their own Bible, the New Testament. And of course, their Bible talked about this God named Jesus, who was not supposed to be anywhere in my Bible. And now they spend the whole evening talking about their God out of my Bible, and I thought that took a lot of nerve. Well, the person who first invited me could see what was going on, and with a bit of wisdom realized that would not be a good night to try to share the four laws with me. But gave me a challenge to take a New Testament home with me and read it for myself and see if he didn't do what the Messiah was supposed to do. And I said, okay, I will do that, not because I was open-minded, because I was going to prove these schizophrenics wrong once and for all. So I went home and began to read the New Testament, and what I thought I would read and what I was reading were two different things. What I thought I'd read about was these big church edifices with stained glass windows, priests with ropes waving statues and bound the statues, waving crosses and telling people, go and kill the Jews in Jesus' name. That's what we saw those calling them Christians doing in Europe. Our assumption was this come from their Bible, New Testament. I was struck by how Jewish this New Testament was. Even the first sentence was intriguing because it opens up with the phrase, the generation of Yeshua the Messiah, the son of Abraham, the son of David. You cannot get more Jewish than that line is. And the Jewishness of the book intrigued me to keep on reading till I was finished. And that caused me to go back the next time into the meeting hall. I wasn't so angry anymore. And I sat down with the same worker, and we went from the prophecies of the Hebrew Bible, the fulfillments of the New Testament. And that night I was fully convinced and became a believer in the Messiahship of Yeshua and the Messiahship of Jesus, and became a schizophrenic myself. Nothing much happened the first year, but then we moved to Los Angeles, and that's when my father's opposition to everything I believed grew in its severity. And finally, I was forbidden to attend any kind of meeting, Jewish or Messianic. I was prohibited to read the Bible of either Testament and things of that nature. When I began my final year of high school, he completely quit speaking to me. And although we lived in the same house that year and we ate the same table, not one word passed from him to me. Roughly about 2 months, he sent me a message. He wouldn't talk to me himself, so he said to my mother that upon graduating from high school, I would have to leave home. That was his requirement. He also asked me to leave the state of California because of a problem. His job, photography, was strictly within the Jewish community, doing different synagogue bar mitzvahs and weddings and things of that nature. And he was afraid the word got out what I believed in, that might endanger the means of making a living. And I was no longer the only child. While in Germany, one brother and one sister were born, and while in Brooklyn, another brother was born, and Los Angeles, 3 more sisters were born. So they were born after I was expelled. So the day after graduation from high school, I started to make my way back to New York City. Before I left, 2 things happened. For the last couple of months, I had a job as a janitor in the Lutheran Church, and I was able to put away $120 by the time I had to leave that job. And secondly, I came across Philippians chapter 4, verse 19, "My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory." So Philippians 4:19 memorized, and then $120 in my pocket, I began to make my way back to New York. It took me 2 weeks to cross the country, but I began to experience Philippians 4:19. Some would give me a ride from one point to another point, a bed here, a meal there. I arrived in New York City, all I spent was $17, and that's it. I worked for a Messianic camp in upstate New York that summer, which for only for room and board, but no pay, so I was down only $20 left by the time the summer ended. I was already accepted to attend a Bible-believing college in New Jersey. That would be a private school, which would run about $750 a year. And this is the early 1960s, and so that was a lot of money back then. And $20 just wouldn't go a long way to cover that. So I came up with this great idea. I thought the idea was so good, I even informed God about my idea. And I said, "Lord, you wouldn't give me peace about taking off a year to get a job and put away some money, so you need to provide the funds." And so that September, I went through a registration program. I walked out of the business office with this bill in my hand for $750 that would have to be paid off within the next 4 months when the semester came to an end. I remember walking down the corridor and praying, "Lord, you would let me work a year first. You're going to have to pay off this bill." But 4 months passed, and not only did God pay off the $700 bill, but the college owed me money. And this continued for 7 of my 8 semesters. I begin every semester with owing the school money, but I always ended with them owing me money. On the 8th semester, we broke out exactly even to the penny, and therefore I got to graduate in 1966. Now, I'm only mentioning the money for tuition. We also be funds you'd have to pay for new textbooks every year, for clothing and things of that nature. And I made a policy which I still keep to this day. I never let anyone know what my personal needs are. I don't ask people to pray for this need or that need, because then they might be moved to meet my need out of sympathy and not out of God's leading. So for me, nobody ever knew what I needed. But still, the money came in from people I never met to this day. I don't even know how they heard about me on a college campus in New Jersey. But I was able to finish school totally not with no debts or anything. Once college ended, I enrolled in a special program for the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. It was a 14-month program. And And they would cost about, altogether, I was going to cost about $2,400. And I was able to work that summer, but all I was able to save was $800. I was still $1,600 short. But about 10 days before I had to board the plane to fly to Israel, I received a letter from the U.S. government informing me I was going to be given a grant. Not a loan I would have to repay someday, but a grant for $1,624. That was $24 more than I actually needed, but that's government bureaucracy for you. And so between what I saved and what they gave me, that covered my whole 14-month expenses while studying at the university in Jerusalem, majoring primarily in historical geography and secondarily in archaeology. And it was during that year while I was in Jerusalem that the Six-Day War broke out. I got to be an eyewitness to many of the events of the Six-Day War, and I was able to still be in Jerusalem when the city was reunited once again as one city. 2 months after the war, my studies completed, I returned to the USA, and I moved on to Dallas Seminary, spent my 4 years studying at Dallas Theological Seminary. I was single my first year, got married between my first and second year. I'll come back to that in a moment. But soon after we got married, my wife and I felt God will lead us both moving back, go back to Israel. She'd never been there, but it'd be a return trip for me to minister in Israel, specifically in Jerusalem. And during those 4 years of seminary, those miraculous types of provisions ceased because I had a part-time job, she had a full-time job, and that met all our needs. We'd not be allowed to work in Israel with the kind of visa we would get, and therefore we have to trust God to provide the funds. And so I finished seminary in 1971. We moved to Israel. Once again, things began to happen that same way. When the rent was due, the month the funds came in, other finances were due, the funds came in. Our first year back was working with the Messianic Assembly in Jerusalem. And then our second year began a one-year Bible Institute with about 20-25 students, half Israelis, half American and British Jews living in Jerusalem at that time. And so that was our ministry, we were reported to the Department of the Interior, and then I was called into the Office of the Interior and told not to bother to apply for an extension on my visa. As soon as before the visa expires, I would have to leave the country. So though we had planned to stay a bit longer, that was not going to be the case. So I came back to New York City, and as God would have it, for 2 years, I became the editor of that same magazine, the cover which was given to my mother in Germany that led to my salvation. And after 2 years in that ministry, I was invited to teach on a Messianic radio program called the Christian Jew Hour, based in San Antonio. And so that brought me to San Antonio, which I now continue to work with our radio ministry in Bible teaching. At that point, God began impressing upon me the need to establish a new type of ministry that will not only practice evangelism, but also to teach the Word of God intensively from a Messianic Jewish perspective. I did not want to be involved in starting a whole new ministry, so I kept putting it off for 2 more years. But in a 2-year period, God brought people into my life that began sharing the same burden with me, and it was implied I should be the one to begin the ministry, and they will join when it was feasible. It became obvious that's the kind of ministry God really brought me through all this training. So though I enjoyed the job I was doing, I resigned from the radio ministry and began Ariya Ministries. And I'll say more about the nature of the ministry in just a bit. And that's been our ministry now for about 38 years. And it continues and expanding. Now, I'll go back to that again in a few minutes. Going back to my wife, I met Marianne 7 years before we got married. I began courting her when we first met, but she was one very stubborn individual. And for 7 years, she kept saying, no, no, no. After 7 years of courtship, she finally saw the light and agreed to the wedding. So I worked just as long for my wife as Jacob, my forefather, worked for his wife, 7 years. And just before the ceremony, that scared me a bit. It scared me because my wife has 2 sisters. We had a Jewish type messianic wedding ceremony. What finalizes the ceremony is your best man takes a wine glass and puts it by your foot, and you proceed to smash the glass. So when my best man took the wine glass and put it by my foot, I first peeked through the veil to make sure it was the right sister, and then I broke the glass. A second piece I'd like to mention is the pastor and his daughter that gave my mother that magazine cover that brought me to faith. After I came to faith and put the pieces of puzzle together, I tried to find out if anybody knew where they were, but nobody, they were out of touch, nobody knew where they were, and after a while I simply gave up. But then my a book published called The Footsteps of the Messiah, which is a prophecy, a book on a prophecy of future events. And about a year or two after it was done in English, it was picked up by a German publisher and they published in German. And not long after the German edition came out, I received a letter from a woman saying years ago she knew a family by the same last name as me, as she had my father's name, my mother's name, my brother and sister's name born in Germany. She couldn't quite figure out who I was because she knew me by my Russian name, which was Zarychek, but it was short for Arik. That's the name she knew me by. She didn't know Arnold because Arnold was my Americanized name when we immigrated. And she turned out to be the daughter of that pastor. And so when we did a trip to Israel on the way back, we stopped off in Germany to visit with her. We found out some details that her father by then had passed away, and she was married thereafter. Her husband knew nothing about me or about my book, but he happened to notice my German book in the bookstore. He bought it only for one reason, because his wife liked Bible prophecy. And so he purchased it for her, and that's how she recognized the name. She also told me that when her father was on his deathbed, she went to see him and asked him, should she keep praying for my salvation? Because she would never know if the prayer was answered. And her father told her, someday you will know the answer, so keep on praying. And when she saw the book, she realized the prayer had finally been answered. But I was already saved years before that. But she kept on praying for my salvation consistently until she finally did learn the truth that I became a believer. Now she came in, she received a blue folder like this. Anyone not have one of these? Will you just raise your hand real quick? Anyone? Now this brochure will give you a basic introduction to the ministry which I direct, our young ministries. Keep your hands up, they'll pass them down. The name Ariel is a Hebrew word meaning the Lion of God. It's an alternate name for the city of Jerusalem. And we begin back in 1977 on two principles. The first principle is to share the gospel to Jewish people. We have several branches here in the USA. We've also spread branches out in different parts of the world, both in Europe and Asia. Also, we have a ministry in Netanya, in Israel, and other places, all together in 10 different countries. And God has used our staff very well, and we have reports regularly of Jewish people coming to faith. Our second major purpose, to teach the word intensively, but from a Messianic Jewish perspective. And we do this in conferences like this. You'll get a taste of this in the study tomorrow morning. And we will be teaching from that perspective. And we shall also print many books and other manuscripts and things of that nature. So in the left-hand foyer, you will see a display table. We have just one copy of each book available from Ariel Ministries. And you can look those over. And as you look at this brochure, we'll give you some other details of what we do in different parts around the world. Two books that would be relevant to what we have, what we talked about today is, these are not Bible teaching books, these are historical books. One book is called When Your Faith Was Your Destiny. This is the story of different branches of the Fruchtenbaum family and their experiences in the Shoah, the Holocaust. And of the 13 families, seven did not survive the war. They were killed in different camps and other places. And the other one moved to Israel. Our family, five families moved to Israel, but my family came to the USA. And then I'll give you the background of my family. This one, someone wrote my son's autobiography. It's a biography called Chosen Fruit. And just to give you all the details I spoke about this evening, but also many other details. I'm going to also point out, as part of our teaching ministry, we now have a special Bible school program at the Adirondacks of upstate New York. You'll find these information sheets. For years, it's been a six-week program. We're going to try an eight-week program this summer. And all of the teachers are Messianic Jewish teachers that are well-versed in this area. And so if you think you might want to attend, but that's for 1 week, 2 weeks, 5 weeks, 8 weeks, whatever, you'll get all of the details here, the different topics, and who's teaching what. And since you live in Florida, the months of July and August is a very good time to get out of this hothouse and come up to beautiful Adirondack Mountains of upstate New York, and you will enjoy the cooler weather and so on, and return thereafter. We also began just last April a online school, the Ariel Online School. You'll find these brochures on it, and you'll find three courses being offered now, but in the last 2 months I taped five more courses, and then since they're ready, there'll be altogether eight courses available. Ultimately, there'll be 20 courses altogether that allows you to complete a Messianic Jewish major. You can take these courses for credit, and therefore take the tests and write the papers. You can simply take the courses at your own benefit, either on your phone or on your computer and things of that nature. So it does give you some basic knowledge on that. Now look at the page that has the coupon type on it. This outlines some ways you can participate with us. Under the phrase, my commitment says, I do indeed feel like myself, the Lord, to number one, pray for the salvation of Jewish people. So, Tampa here does have a Jewish community, or from other places you may have lived, you may know Jewish people from the past to the present. And I would encourage you to pray for their salvation by name, whether they were friends or schoolmates or workmates or neighbors. But then go beyond praying for their salvation. Secondly, do I get to give them the good news of Jesus the Messiah? And if you're a Gentile believer, there are two very good tools you can use. And the first tool is your own testimony. What's important about your testimony is this. When we grew up in the Jewish community, we do not distinguish between Christians and Gentiles. We use those terms synonymously. If you're not born a Jew, that makes you a Gentile. That part is true, but does not make you a believer. Does not make you a biblical Christian. And so in your testimony, what you want to bring out is that while you were born a Gentile, you could not be born believing something. You're not born a Christian in the biblical sense. And until a Jewish person can make the separation of his mind between Gentiles and believers, it'll be very difficult for him to begin investigating the claims of Yeshua, the claims of Jesus to be the Messiah. A second effective tool is using gospel literature that is written for the Jewish people. And we publish certain gospel packets that deal with specific questions like the Trinity issue and the virgin birth issue and things of that nature. And so you can give this to a Jewish contact and see what happens. Over the years, I've discovered that many Gentiles who have Jewish friends or relatives but will not share the gospel with them because they're afraid of a negative reaction. So because of that fear factor, they simply won't do it. So if you're in that position, here's what I recommend you can do. Get a hold of our Jewish packet anyway, put it inside an envelope, and mail it to your Jewish contact without giving your name or address away. In our ministry, we call this approach chicken evangelism, but it's been known to work. I've met Jewish believers that became believers because someone had done that just that way. So if you don't do it any other way, give chicken evangelism a try. It can't hurt. If you're afraid they may know where it came from because of the address, so if you live here, go to another town, mail it from there. If from another town, mail it from here, and so on. But it's important that we don't let fear keep us from sharing the gospel to our Jewish people. Fourthly, to pray for the work of our young ministries. We publish a magazine, which I'll share with you in a moment. We also publish every 2 months a prayer booklet, prayer requests that come from all the different branches we now have around the different parts of the world. So that with that aspect, you can begin praying for them as well, for the branches. We publish as a Bible teaching magazine. It comes out quarterly every 3 months. It gives you short statements, short reports about different branches around the world. But the main emphasis here is having 3 up to 5 different biblical studies from this Messianic Jewish perspective, and we did not charge for the magazine. It's free of charge, and there's 2 ways you can get it. If you want to receive the hard copy, which looks like this, then in the slip, just give us your full name and address, so we can mail it to you that way. Or if you wish to receive merely as an email, just give us your email address and that will be sufficient. We're happy to send it to you for as long as you want to receive it. So these are different facets of what is now Aria Ministries. We have 15 minutes left for any questions you might want to ask. Our topic tomorrow is going to be called the basis or precondition to the second coming. The basis or precondition to the second coming, I'll give you a better example of what it means. They're teaching the scriptures from the Jewish frame of reference. And we're gonna do it in 2 parts, that we have the first session at 10, we'll cover it as much as we can, and then we'll have the second session in the second service to finish the rest of the same topic. So that'll be the topic for tomorrow night. So you can ask any question that you would like, but if you ask me a question I'll be dealing with tomorrow, I'll ask you to wait till then to get the answer. Otherwise, there are no limitations. You have a question, raise your hand, and we'll go from there. Who's got the first question? Over here. Is there a microphone? Can you?
I can speak loudly. Could you make a comment as to, are you still in exile from your father and mother? Not that they might be living now, but your...
Well, my father and I never reconciled at his choice.
And how about
your passed away.
Siblings?
My mother's still living. She's 95. But she has somehow not been open to the Lord. Every time we get close to the thing, she shuts the window very quickly. But I'm allowed to visit, at least since my father died, I wasn't allowed to visit. And once he passed away, I'm now visit. So she was never as anti-me as my father was. But one thing she won't discuss yet at 95 is anything about the Messiah.
And your siblings?
I have two brothers and 4 sisters. One sister, Sally, passed away from overdose and drugs, but none of them are believers as yet. My sister, before she passed away, she was a lawyer. And they used to tell people, pray for my brothers and sisters for their salvation. Don't pray for my sister because she's not savable because she's a lawyer. And then my brother was CEO of American Greetings, which is that big Get Well Card company. His average salary before he retired was $600,000 a year. So I asked people to pay for his salvation so I can collect his tithe. Question?
You mentioned the 3 C's, and how do you deal with questions from Jewish folks about the persecution and anti-Semitism that's been historically part of
the church history, and you cannot hide from it. It's very well blanketed. But my response is, just because something was done in Jesus' name doesn't make Jesus responsible. And this example from Jewish history, because in the intertestamental period, 2 of the Hasmoneans, which were the sons of the Maccabees, forcibly converted different Gentile groups to Judaism. So like one of them converted the Edomians into Judaism, out of which came Herod the Great, and so on. But so although he did that in the name of Moses, he can't hold Moses responsible. Moses never teaches convert Gentiles at the point of a sword. So just because the church did so and forcefully converted many Jews to Christianity or Catholicism, the church is held responsible for it, but you can't hold Yeshua, you can't hold Jesus responsible for it. So look at the New Testament, see what he really said, not what people said in his name, but what he really said in the text of Scripture. If I get to that point, then I've gotten to the first base. Question?
What we see happening right now in the Middle East, can we equate this with what we read in Ezekiel 38?
Well, you can't equate it yet because it hadn't happened yet. we have to be very careful not to interpret the Bible by current events. We have to see how the current events run. And Bible prophecy is never fulfilled approximately. It's always fulfilled precisely and exactly. Do you have a full fulfillment and have a fulfillment? So the things happening at the moment that's going to fulfill Ezekiel 39, we do not yet know. So we have to avoid jumping the gun. And let's wait and see how things pass out. Over the years, since Ronald Reagan, every time we had a new president, somebody wrote a book trying to prove that this person is the Antichrist. And the evidence for Ronald Reagan was because his first name, middle name, last name had six letters. He had 666, as if God was enamored with the Latin alphabet we now use, and so on. And during the Clinton presidency, I was asked whether he was the Antichrist, does his name equal 666? Again, I would just say, no, Bill Clinton does not equal 666. Hillary Clinton equals 666. That was just a joke. And now, I have no doubt that eventually, that someone's going to write a book with our president today trying to prove he's the Antichrist. And it may be called The Last Trump. But at this point, we have to be careful. We're trying to find fulfillment before it's fulfilled.
Whenever I talk to my Jewish friends about Messianic Jews, they always say that if you come and follow Yeshua as your Messiah, you're not a Jew anymore. And of course, I say Jews are those that are descendants of Abraham, and they nod their head, but they still say you're not Jewish. Do you have a few comments?
That's Rabbinic view. The Rabbinic view labels all Messianic Jews as being non-Jews. But you got to push their inconsistency. So what is it? So define me what a Jew is. Don't tell me what he's not. Tell me what is a Jew. And their statement's like, a Jew believes in only one God. Well, we believe in only one God. And most Jews today tend to be atheistic, agnostic. They don't believe in any God. So how come they're Jewish and we're not? You just have to keep pressing, because they cannot come up with a label for Jewishness that fits all Jews except us. So you just have to press them on it. But that is the official position, that we're not Jews anymore. Question? Any other questions?
I see you're based in San Antonio, and our daughter and her large family attend Wayside. And I think they mentioned that you either went there sometimes or had a
connection. I was a member of that church when we first lived in San Antonio, before we moved to California. Then we came back to San Antonio, but the Wayside Chapel is a very good church, but it has become a mega church. I'm not comfortable with these mega churches and assembly line going. So I joined, I'm a part of a Messianic congregation called Beit Simcha, where we meet on Shabbat and Saturday morning. Also I'm part of a small congregation, a strong congregation, but very small, called Community Chapel. And that's where I would go on my free Sundays, which I don't have many of those, but I would go. But Wayside Chapel is a good church. It's just, I just don't care for these mega churches as a member. Yes?
I have some very dear friends, a husband and wife, that are Jewish. And they recently moved from the Tampa area to Fort Lauderdale, and I continue my relationship with them. They are really, really close to me, and I'm close to them. We have a very mutual appreciation for each other. Oftentimes I've told them, I hope I don't offend you by saying this because you're a Jew, but whenever I feel God's love, whenever I feel your love, I feel like you're being Jesus with skin on to me. And they always accept that and are appreciative of that compliment. And they believe that Jesus did exist and he walked on the face of the earth. I think that they believe a lot of the historicity about Jesus.
Oh yeah, most Jews today do.
But they don't think that he's the Messiah.
Right.
And I'm wondering if there's any one part of scripture that I could appeal to them to interest, I don't know what I'm trying to say, And also, I've been building bridges with them, as much as possible bridges, to share my heart with them, and they share their heart with me. And they kind of jokingly said, you know, sometimes I don't think I'm Christian enough to X, Y, Z. You know, they will say that to me. And I feel like they're more Christian than a lot of Christians are. Their heart is just such, so golden. You know, they have such a generous heart and loving heart. And I wonder if building a bridge might be that I become a Messianic Jew.
Well, are you Jewish?
No.
Then you cannot be a Messianic Jew. You could be a Messianic Gentile, but you can't be a Messianic Jew. But first of all, as Paul points out, even if you have to present the cross of the Messiah, and to the Jews it may be an offense, and often is, but you cannot let that stop you. But for real details, there's two books in the temple that are written for the unbelieving Jewish person. One is called Jesus Was a Jew. Just a simpler approach, given with specific passages. Looking for one key passage, that would be Isaiah 52, verse 13, to chapter 53, verse 12. A much more book, once they're into that, if they want more, they're more deeper, it's one called HaMashiach, that's Hebrew for the Messiah, what the Hebrew scriptures teach about the Messiah. And what it does, it gives you all of the first coming prophecies, but we put it Hebrew on one side, English on the other, because sometimes rabbis teach their congregants that if you're being witnessed to, then just tell them that the rabbi notified you that the Christian Bibles are mistranslated, so it looks like him, but not really to the Hebrews. So when somebody uses that, well, here's the Hebrew, here's the English, tell me what's mistranslated. And most Jews, here in America, won't be able to do that. Most Jews don't know Hebrew, so on. But even if they do know Hebrew, they won't be able to see any mistranslation. But there you have a clear little comparison, and that would be a secondary book, but I would give the easy one first and then see if there's room for the other one. But you should read that first just to see how we approach the Jewish person with the gospel. Read it first before you give it to them. We have four more minutes.
Maybe you can answer this question. Someone that taught the Bible to me, I studied with for about 15 years, always would say, what did the Jews do now for sacrifice? Because after the curtain was torn, there were no more blood sacrifices made, and they believe that in order to atone for your sins, you had to have the sacrificial blood.
Well, the sacrifices themselves did not stop when the torn was torn. That's it. Sacrifices continued till the year 70 when the temple was standing. They were no longer acceptable by God, but the sacrifices continued till AD 70. When the temple was destroyed, there was no room for sacrificing anymore. But that was not the first time that happened, because in the 70 years between the destruction of the first temple and the building of the second one, there were no sacrifices either. With no temple, there's no sacrifices. So the rabbis say, well, we had to do it for 70 years with no sacrifices till the temple is rebuilt. And for those Orthodox Jews, we will resume the sacrifices, but we have to wait till the temple is rebuilt. So it's the lack of a temple. The rabbis provided certain substitutes that you can practice until the temple is rebuilt, such as fasting on the Day of Atonement from, that's a 26-hour fast of both solids and liquids, giving to charity. And when I was living in the Jewish displaced person camps, every Yom Kippur, every Day of Atonement, the rabbi came in and they would sacrifice a chicken, a hen for women, a rooster for the men, three times over this way in certain prayers. Most American Jews don't practice that today except for the Ultra Orthodox. But that was the practice of the Jews in these deep displaced persons camps. So they already have a prerequisite precedence, I should say. There were no sacrifices for 7 years. There was no temple. They rebuilt the temple. When that was destroyed, we could no longer sacrifice. So they quit sacrifices in the year 70, not the year 30. And so in Rabbinic Judaism, Orthodox Judaism, the ideal is to have the temple rebuilt. But there are the disagreement in Orthodoxy, which is the smaller group, says we first build the temple, then the Messiah comes. The majority of you among the Orthodox know we we wait for the Messiah to come and then he'll build a temple, and that discussion is going on. We know biblically, ultimately, a temple will be rebuilt before the second coming. Okay, 1, 2, and they'll have to quit.
Okay, in your book, Israelology, you mentioned all the covenant, amillennial, and postmillennial, dispensational, all of that. Could you give me a Messianic Jews fitting into one general category with respect to hermeneutics?
Most Messianic Jews, not all, but most Messianic Jews are premillennial. They do believe the Messiah will come, not necessarily dispensational, but premillennial. And so Messiah returns, there will be a Messianic kingdom thereafter, as was found in the history. There's a minority of Messianics that are mill or post-mill, but they're in the minority. And the tribulation, most today in America at least, are post-trib. I'm pre-everything, I'm pre-trib, pre-mill. I won't even eat post-toasties for breakfast to avoid any appearance of false teaching. There's one hand from there, okay?
Yes, I was wondering, do the Jews still believe in God? I mean, it's been so long that they've been praying.
Most American Jews and most Israelis don't believe in the God per se. Many are atheists. A lot are atheists, a lot are just agnostic. They don't know if God exists or doesn't exist, but doesn't play a role in their life. So among the Jewish people today, Jews who are Orthodox, ultra-Orthodox, even conservative, all believe in God. Among the Reform, you have a whole range of those that believe in God, there's some force, and you even have Reform rabbis who are atheistic. And you even have a group called Humanistic Judaism. They put out a Passover booklet to use for Passover. There's no mention of God in this whole book. So the majority of Jewish people, they're not in any kind of any God consciousness. That doesn't mean that they deny being Jewish. They have a Jewish connection, they have a Jewish loyalty, and they do believe in the Jewish goal of tikkun olam, meaning the fixing of the world to make the world a better place. Only Orthodox, ultra-Orthodox, in those realms of what we call traditional Judaism of New Testament times. Let me close with one of my favorite rabbi stories. What's common about rabbi stories is there's a logic there, but the logic just doesn't work right. And the background to the story is that in Judaism, we're never taught to pray extemporaneously. All our prayers were from prayer books. There's a daily prayer book, a Sabbath prayer book, a prayer book for every holy occasion. Rabbi is now elderly, he's retired from the rabbinate. He came to realize in his old age, he does not know the God of Israel any better now than when he was a child. He made a very unusual decision for Rabbi. He closed his prayer book for the first time, pray with his own words, that maybe he'll hear the voice of God. And if so, he has a few questions to get to know this God better. He closed his prayer book and began using his own words. In the beginning, he stumbled a lot. He was not used to praying that way. After a while, it got smoother, more eloquent. After going on for a very long time, you heard a voice from heaven saying, "Yes, Rabbi, what do you want from me?" Rabbi says, "I want to ask you just a few questions to get to know you better." And God says, "So ask." My first question is, "What does time mean to you?" And God says, "Time to me is like this. 1 second is like 1,000,000 years. 1,000,000 years is just like 1 second. Rabbi says, "Huh?" My second question is, what does money mean to you? And God says about the same. To me, a penny is like $1,000,000, $1,000,000 like 1 penny. Rabbi says, in that case, O Lord, I have a third question. May I please have one of your pennies? And God said, of course, just wait 1 second.